Thank you. one day. The higher intellect, the imagination. Seekers of crazy force. Thank you.
by definition, UFOs include the one I saw are unidentified. Simply infer their spacecraft. You can still have some fun playing with the idea.
Gentlemen, in the mix.
Says the car's here, but it's just like a regular ride hail situation where I have to walk around and figure out where it's actually stopped.
Gentlemen in the mix.
is sponsored by Grammarly.
Welcome back to my channel. I just moved into this new apartment. It's a studio apartment in Manhattan, and I only moved in 4 days ago, and I'm still riding the high about moving in, and I'm gonna start off this video by showing you some of the new things I bought for this place, and also how much I paid for rent, because I realized in my last video I didn't get to do that. All right, first, new item number one is a piano stand and this piano chair. Never really learned piano, and I wanted to learn, so I bought this setup, and I think having this here is gonna help me learn to play more. I got this big monstera plant, and my desk is facing my view here. This is the view at night, and this is also my latest addition, corner light. In terms of rent,
Jeff!
Elliot! Yeah, come on in. What's up, man?
Wow, timing is amazing.
Shout out to Elliot for this monstera. He's in this area a lot, so I've been hanging out with him a lot recently. Yeah, dude, so I was just thinking, you've been texting me a lot, and honestly, like, your grammar has not been the best, I'm not gonna lie.
What?
You should check out Grammarly.
What is Grammarly?
Grammarly's digital writing assistant continues to help me every day. With my writing. If you're a student or a working professional and you still don't have it yet, now is the time. Even if you don't have a writing job, Grammarly is game-changing when it comes to better online communication. I see the benefits of Grammarly the most when I'm writing emails. Thanks to Grammarly Premium's confident tone suggestions, I'm sounding more capable, confident, and sure. Not only is it helping me write better emails, but it's also helping me push out emails much more quickly. I spend way less time writing emails these days because Grammarly offers me suggestions in real time. A lot of my work life is involved in writing emails, and these days I rely so heavily on their writing suggestions. This really takes the pressure off me because I can sometimes communicate in a way that sounds unintentionally uncertain or unconfident. The last thing you want is your writing.
Okay, well. Okay. Okay. All right. So, why does my hair look so weird? I'm about to shoot the YouTube video part thing now. With my crusty ass hair. Okay, now it's a bit straight. So, Forty-six minutes. Okay. Hi there. If you're reading this video title and you're watching this video, it must mean that you're having some sort of trouble finding a job, and you must be in college or at least in the software engineering / computer science space. Without going into too much detail, I felt the need to give a brief overview of that process and what it takes to actually make it, as I've had to go through the same process myself. A lot of people think one of two things. They either think that there are certain things that you must do to make it, or it's the path of trying to figure out what it takes to make it that actually helps you make it. And I believe that it's both, all right? Doing things like updating your resume, completing personal projects, attempting capstone projects as well. I don't know if your school might offer it or not, but like completing cookie cutter projects just to stack up your resume and have like a heavy amount of project experience is great. Also having your personal like projects that you're working on is also good. This is a quick little trick that I do myself, which is linking demos to your projects, showing it actually working, or maybe not even working, but describing it and showing potential employers that you know what you're talking about. A majority of recruiters or people that will be looking at your resume, the people that you want to impress first are non-technical people. So you want to talk about, as far as your resume goes, you want to talk about impact of what you're doing, not just what you're doing and what technology you're using. A person reading it would not go, oh, this person worked with Visual Studio and did Node.js and React Native and this and that and this and that. They'll just shut that shit off. The most important thing is relating to a non-technical person and, like I said, describing the impact that your work has so that they know where to place you. So say, for example, a company is looking for a person to fit a specific role in, let's say, research and development. So they're looking for someone who does a lot of research. And if you say that your work impacts research or has something to do with research, then they know, okay, this person is the right person for our job. They don't go, oh, this person has worked with Node.js and this and that, and we need someone with Node.js. No, it's more specifically about a role that you can fulfill within a team. I think I went into a little bit of detail there. I'm trying not to do that. This is just a general overview. But like I mentioned, it's doing certain things with your resume, going to career fairs, applying for a lot of jobs, making a lot of resumes, catering your resume to different types of jobs and stuff like that, having a good outline, removing unnecessary information. Just doing your homework when it comes to resumes is super important. I don't recommend going to your school advisor. I recommend doing your own research when it comes to resumes. Watching YouTube was really helpful for me. And I found some good templates to go off of. The second thing is just your attitude when trying to get a job. You can't go, oh, I'm going to just do these things. I'm going to have the best resume. I'm going to just smash lead code. I'm going to just do the things that are necessary, but I won't have that energy and that drive. Then you won't get it. Because you can make it without those things, but you have the drive. But having those things and doing what's necessary without having the drive, it's not going to work. But having both, I think, is the best, like I said before. Now, with the drive, it's just, you can't just watch a video and say, oh, I watched the video, I do what's necessary, and I should have a job. I did all the LeetCo questions. Hey, no, that's not how it works. How it works is you dedicate all of your time to fixing your resume, applying for jobs, and like I said, going to career fairs, but doing that all the time. Like living and breathing it. I'm not saying live and breathe LeetCo questions. Those are important for the technical side of things, but you want to be able to land interviews first. Once you're able to land interviews, and let's say you get to the technical portion and you start to fail, then focus on the technical side. But the first part is impressing people enough that they want to talk to you more and find out more about what's going on with you. Part of that is having a good enough GPA and making it no more than a page. But yeah, I'm trying to dig a little deeper when it comes to the drive. It's really hard to explain, but think of an abyss. Like, think of what'll happen if you don't get a job, you know? And just do, I think this is the best way I can describe it. Just doing everything in your power to get it. researching everything, you know? So it's not just, oh, I'm going to do these things because it worked for this person. Yes, for me, for example, I did certain things that worked, but what ultimately got me my job or internship was being enthusiastic about everything. That includes doing things that may or may not have helped me. It's in failing from certain tasks or certain things that I did that I was able to recognize which ones were positive and then focus all my energy on those, if that makes sense. So it's the process of trying and failing at different things and not just gunning for things that, like, someone else said that worked for them. Because what worked for one person might not work for you. You're not in the same position I was, where I had a lot of capstone projects. Maybe you don't, and maybe you need to figure something else out. You need to look within yourself and do some research and do everything that it takes, which means trying all of it, not just those specific things. So that is the best advice that I can give, as well as don't necessarily take advice. I know this is kind of hypocritical, counterintuitive maybe, but it's to take your own advice and try things for yourself. I think that's what this video is going to be about. It's not necessarily following someone's path, but taking certain things from other people and then just taking the good and leaving out the bad, and then seeing what works for you. So that's the end of this video. I hope you enjoyed. I will try to make more content like this. I cannot promise for sure, but please leave a comment and tell me or ask me what it is you would like to know, and I will try to make a video about that. But again, it's all about your mindset, it's all about your perspective and being willing to fail. So have a good one. Okay, so from 46 to 56, so it's about a 10-minute video. Okay, well, it's done. I just thought I'd make that since I'm watching Jet Cal do it.
To get interpreted in the wrong tone. You can download Grammarly, which easily integrates in your daily life. It works where you work, not only in emails, but also in so many other apps and websites. The right tone can move your projects forward with Grammarly. Go to grammarly.com/jedcal to sign up for an account, and if you'd like to level up your writing and tone, upgrade to Grammarly Premium for 20% off.
So yeah, I'm paying $3,800. It also comes with a gym, and I think living in New York for the past, I'd say like 8 months, has really numbed me to how inflated everything became in the city. When I lived in New York the first time, I was paying $1,900. Rent is definitely a lot more expensive now, but in terms of happiness, because of my bright windows and the great view, I feel like I'm more productive and...
Something I've noticed is my general happiness is directly correlated to how much natural light my room gets. Since I technically work from home and spend most of my time on my desk, my environment plays a huge role. So the view and the lighting really sold me on why I decided to take the spot. The only other time I've lived alone was in LA, but it was—
man, this guy, why didn't he stay with—
mid-quarantine when everything was closed. So I did have a really tough time because of that. It's different times now, and I'm excited to try out New York City in a different light. This time around, I'm coding, I'm making videos, I have a few friends around. So I'm excited to see where this year takes me. One big effect I've already seen from living alone is that I cook for myself pretty much every meal now. Something motivating about having your own kitchen, your own dishes. I cook a total of probably like 5 times in my last apartment. So this is exciting to be into cooking again. I just got boba here in K-Town. I had to come out because this is the first time I've seen heavy snow in New York since like 2019. I don't know if it looks like snow or just like rain on—
Pilates has been on my...
Okay, post class up.
Okay, that class...
It's because it's...
Guys, like, my... is...
Gentlemen in the mix. We'll be right back.
race fastest performance SUVs, and it is AMG's GLC 63S, and I've left this for a long time. This is, of course, my own car. You guys have been clamoring for it on Instagram. I've now covered more than 7,000 miles in this. So there's a lot to feedback to you guys about what this car is like. But first, I want to frame it logically for you to understand exactly where this is placed. Because when you look at it, your brain tricks you into thinking it's just like a GLE. Why does this car even exist? And because of the shape and the design of it, you're also thinking it's a very similar size. But I'll get onto size later. This is not the way I want you to think about the car. While it may be similar to the GLE, I want you to think of it as the closest thing that we currently have to a four-wheel drive C63. And that's why this car is so compelling, and I'll qualify that as we go along in the review. Now, of course, the GLC is based on the C-Class platform, and thus it's got an almost identical interior. And compared to the C63, it's running the same tune as that car. So we've got the 4-liter V8 bi-turbo, what I call AMG's best engine ever, with 503 brake horsepower, 700 newton meters of torque. So the same figures you get in the C63S, but in this, which is now a small performance SUV. And then, of course, there's the looks. It's very C63 in its looks, especially compared to the recently facelifted C63 that we tested. Oh, sorry, this has been playing up recently. Let's try that again. That's better. So it does have that Panamericana grille. It's got a very aggressive front end compared to the facelift. In fact, there's more than a little AMG GTR going on this as well. And it's not just the grille. I think a lot of the lower half looks very similar to the GTR, and in fact, very similar to the AMG GT four-door as well, in that lower air intake area. So it looks very, very up to date from the front end. Now, of course, all of the top dog AMGs get this, the racing GT3 grille from the AMG GT3, what used to be called the Panamericana grille. Now it's on all of the top breed of the AMG. So every 63, the GTs, the next A45S that's coming, they're all gonna have this Panamericana grille, and it's to signify immediately that this is the top dog of that range. Now, as I said, the design fools you into thinking that this is actually a much larger car. So if we look then in comparison to the GLE, you can see how much bigger the GLE and its footprint. It is a mammoth of a car compared to the much more svelte GLC. But then when you see it in person and you see how squat the stance is, how it sits on those ridiculously large 21-inch wheels with the wide tires, the wide arches. It looks like a C63S that's been injected with steroids, fed copious amounts of 100 RON fuel, and it's like a bicep that's about to pop. It just looks absolutely incredible, almost like a caricature of a normal car. I really do like the lights on the front end. They're a bit different to C63 in the way that they light up and shine, a bit thicker, and it just looks quite cool. Thank you. Coming along to the side, as I said, you've got those massive 21-inch wheels.
Gabe has had one fight!
Oh god,
he had one fight! How the hell is he taking
a fight? To be fair, that's true.
Any of you, anyone who wants it, Gabe, come here. I'll smash you up as well.
I don't think Gabe is really that guy. He just fought a weakling, like, you know, Austin McBroom. Nah, he's not that guy.
I know for a fact I'd win that fight if I fought Gabe again. 1,000%.
It's been years, Gibby! Where you were, man, let's go! Hold on right now!
I have collected many chins over these years, but you simply do not forget your first. The poor lad didn't stand a chance. In 2018, YouTube boxing was all fun and games, but my last two fights were personal.
Even though he beat Taylor Holder, it's a draw. Like, it was,
on the night, it was a draw.
This is the end. Hold your breath and count to 10. Feel the earth move and then hear my heart burst again. For this is the end. I've drowned and dreamt this moment. So overdue, I owe day. Swept away, I'm stolen.
Oh, right, he dropped off.
But the question is, what's next for Gibber? After months of negotiations, it is narrowed down to three papers on the table. A six-figure deal to fight the Brooklyn Beggar. Let me think about it. Never! No one calls me six figures. Now that's what we're talking about. Seven figs for Mayweather. Maybe I teach that old man a lesson. What's gonna be a Mayweather tournament? Multi-millions? So many papers, so many peas, but what's the right choice? I conquered the last promotion that I was on. I first defeated their most feared fighter and finished them off by knocking out the CEO. But to prove that I am the best, I must now conquer another promotion, but which one? We have seen some amazing battles in the past, but this time it's bigger and better than ever before. Eight of the best fighters on YouTube are going head-to-head in a three-event boxing tournament to decide who is the best pound-for-pound YouTube boxer. March the 12th, the eight fighters will face off in a live tournament draw to see who they will be facing in the electrifying qualifier event on April 22nd. The qualifiers is just the beginning. The second event is going to be even more intense. These fighters know each other's strengths and weaknesses, and they are going to be looking for every opportunity to take advantage of. The third and final event is where it all comes down to. Who will be crowned pound for pound YouTube boxer? You'll have to be there to find out.
We'll be right back.
Gentlemen in the Mix.
are what you are. What you are. Somebody, 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 somebody. Ain't nobody. Thank you.
respect for being in all of this. No disrespect for being in all of this. No disrespect for being in all of this. Thank you.
each other's written values. Thresh the is a situation can occur when two threads running on two different CPUs are writing to two different variables which happen to be stored within the same CPU cache line, which is writing to this left variable here, which will eventually get flushed all the way down to main memory. But when it writes to the left, to this left variable, the value is first written to a CPU registers, then flushed all the way down here. And thread 3 is doing the same thing, just writing to the write variable here, and it eventually will get flushed down through all the cache layers and into main memory. And the reason, of course, for this flushing is so that the two threads can eventually see each other's written values. When a CPU reads data from main memory, that data is transported up through the caches here and is kept in the caches up here for faster access for the CPU. However, the CPU does not just read a single byte at a time from main memory up into the caches here. That would be very inefficient. So what it does instead is it reads a cache line, which is a sequence of bytes at a time that is being read from main memory up through the cache layers. And this sequence of bytes is often 64 bytes, but it depends on the underlying hardware architecture. So it could be 32 bytes, it could be 128 bytes, it could be 256 bytes. That completely depends on the underlying hardware architecture. Sometimes two CPUs, meaning two threads running on two different CPUs, might be reading and writing variables that are different, but which are stored close to each other in main memory. And when that happens, that means that instead of just reading this variable here, which this thread one here is using, it reads the whole cache line, which also contains variable two. Now thread one here and CPU one does not need variable two for anything, but thread three here and this second CPU here, that actually needs the variable two for something. And so what happens is,
Gentlemen in the mix.